What were some of the books that affected you?
I mean, back then, of course, it's those kids' books. It's the Hardy Boys. Alfred Hitchcock had a series called The Three Investigators. You know, young kids like myself, but pulled into extraordinary and meaningful adventures where they use their intelligence and their wits to help people and solve problems. There's a humility to it that you learn as well. Of all the things I've learned in life, humility is the one that's led to the biggest growth and changes. There's that saying, it's the sand and the oyster that creates the pearl. So it was just being really lonely, both in my household and in school, feeling alienated, feeling like I didn't belong. And then one day I discovered books, and it brought me into this world where it was just fascinating, it was adventurous, it was exciting, it was connecting, and became more exciting than school. I recently got like a box of my old school writings, and I saw that in second grade, I wrote, you know, when I grow up, I want to be a writer, and I want to own a million books and have a kid and teach him how to ride a bicycle. That was the entire essay.
Wow.
And I'm almost there. Once I teach my son how to ride a bicycle, my life is done and complete.
What was the first time that your writing connected with people, with the world?
It was in Chicago at a Public Enemy Sonic Youth concert, and there was a riot outside. And it was misreported in all the press about what was going on with the riot, and I had like the only article, because I was there and talked to everybody, that was really accurate about it. And I saw the article being mentioned on the news and editorials about it, and I realized that it was important to be somewhere, see it with your own eyes, talk to everybody, and tell the truth when it wasn't being told.
What do you think about the state of the media today?
It's such an interesting world, not just these last few months, but the last few years. We've gone from a place where the news was like loss leader. It was, you know, a network's obligation to do the news. They didn't make much money off it, but they reported the news. And then we went to a place where news is entertainment and news is partisan agendas. And the more fear you get, the more media conglomerates profit. Now we're literally always getting the news. Every second, and it feels more immediate, it creates more fear. And on top of that, you're surrounding yourself with a thought bubble of just people who agree with you, and it's just distorting people's view of reality. And the scary thing is there's less dialogue and there's less room for opposing viewpoints to exist in the same space.
What are some of the big issues facing the world today?
Here's the deal. Do you know how few people die of terrorism a year versus how many die of smoking? How many people die of suicide? How many people die of obesity? The biggest thing, over 100-fold, that anyone listening to this has to worry about for their own lives is themselves. We're sitting here talking about a lot of the issues and the problems in the world, and I think it's because we don't take our own emotional and psychological health seriously as a culture. We go to a doctor for checkups, for our health, for our physical health. We go to school for intellectual education, but we do nothing for our emotional and psychological health. And I guess if there's one thing I would love to see in the world, it's starting to take our emotional and psychological health and teaching that intelligence early, because I believe that the secret to world peace is healthy parenting. I talked to geneticists because I was curious, how stuck are we with ourselves? And they said there is nothing in your behavior that is purely genetic. Everything is turned on by something in the environment, even schizophrenia and psychopathy. But healthy parenting, that's what I'd love to see in the world.
What do you think about the future?
I collect old books. And if I showed you a book from 1600 and 1700, just by looking, you probably wouldn't know the difference what was printed 100 years from later. The technology didn't change. But now change is happening so rapidly. You look at, say, the iPhone 1 versus the iPhone 7. These science fiction dreams are all in motion. So there's this amazing world that's being built and constructed. And everything that brings us closer to our own epiphany as human beings also brings us closer to our own destruction. So the question is, which way are we going to turn as a society, and how can you and I and everybody bring things toward wholeness, togetherness, betterment, growth, positivity, and taking care of each other and the planet?
What are some of the biggest lessons you've learned in your life?
Let go of your own story. Let go of the lies you tell yourself. That belief that I'm not enough, I don't fit in. And these didn't come from us. These came from emotionally abusive parent, a caregiver, someone else. You know, whether you're 15, 20, 30, 40, that's a lot of years with living with that belief. So it's a process that might take years for you to tell yourself the opposite long enough. If you can see that your story is not truth, if you can see that it was someone else loading you up with their own baggage, and if you can let go of that story and be the parent to yourself that you never had, you can then, you know, embrace the world and embrace life. So I think the biggest lesson I learned is the inner world is a garden to be cultivated. And I love a quote from Bob Dylan who said, you know, I'm never arriving, I'm always becoming. And so that's one of my goals, is just to continue the process of becoming.